Hi, everyone. Welcome. My name is Marilyn Shannon, and I am so delighted to bring you SkyWire to do each and every Thursday. This is exciting. Love it. It's all about listening and unraveling the meaning of life on many, 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 many different levels. And today we're going to be talking about listening and nature, listening into nature, listening to what nature has in store for us. And I'm really our panel of friends in our green room, along with a very special guest, Sue Aston, who many of you very well might know. She is a concert violinist, and she has so much to share with us. So I want to welcome her. Hey, Sue.
Hello. Hi, everybody. It's good to be here today.
It's really nice to have you here, and it's nice to be listening to you. I love how you sound, so thanks for being here.
Thank you.
And I want to welcome Heidi. Hey, Heidi. And Elaine. Welcome, Elaine. You made it. And Gail.
Hi,
hey, Gail.
Hey, great to be here.
And cool. And Katrina. And Sheila is in our, Sheila's everywhere. I don't know where Sheila is right now, but she's a fly on our wall. And she is like the producer, and she comes in, and she goes out, and she makes sure that everything is in excellence. And I want to thank her for doing that. George Green, who's usually here, cannot be here today, so we want to say hi to him, because he's going to be listening when this is in a replay. And Tracy couldn't be with us, and maybe she'll come in a little while, but we love her, but she's not here right now either. So let's go down the line and ask each one of our friends in the green room to share a little bit about them so you know who you are listening to. So let's start with Heidi. Heidi, tell everybody a little bit about you.
Yeah, I'm Heidi. I'm at the moment working as a transformational coach and as a workshop leader in relationship questions. And before, and I'm still doing that, I'm a classical singer and a voice coach and voice therapist, and listening for musicians is one of the main things. So I'm very happy that Susan today is here, with whom I'm connected by the love for music.
Wonderful. And what about you, Elaine? Elaine, can you hear me? Okay. Elaine can't hear me.
She's so muted. Elaine, you are muted.
Okay. All right, let's start with Gail then. Gail, can you share who you are?
Sure, I'd love to. I'm Gail Harris, and it's great to be here. I'm a professional writer and author, and I specialize in writing books for other people, so I have to do a lot of listening with that. And I have co-written a memoir that'll be out on December 7th entitled Finding Zoe, and it's an amazing story. Thanks.
Well, I'm glad you're here. And Katrina, what about you?
I'm also a professional writer and a creativity coach, and I have a huge passion for helping people learn how to listen to themselves a little better and really tap into that creative voice within so they can share it in all that they do. I'm really excited about the chat today because I'm a huge nature person, and I do feel that there's a whole other different level of listening and connection that you can get when you're outside. So I'm really excited for today.
Yeah, I love how you put things. So thank you for explaining that one. And Sheila, as I said, is out in the comment area. And Sheila teaches realtors. And so we all can see it so we can read it in the comments, because it's really important that she share who she is. And Elaine, she'll be back here in just a minute, I know. Okay, Heidi, you have a comment? Heidi, is that a comment?
Yes, it is Sheila, she says. Most welcome, Marilyn Shannon. Love being in the audience. So she loves to be in the audience.
Okay great. Elaine, thank you for that. And then
Okay. Oh, it's gone again.
There she goes. Okay. Well, we'll get her. I am a life business coach, and I'm passionate about helping people listen to their strengths, to their gifts, and tooting their horns, and people connecting and doing all kinds of things, and I do that on multiple levels, and I'm a facilitator of life, so it's great to be here. Sue, now I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay.
And I want you to give us a little bit about who you are.
Okay, well, I'm Sue Aston. I'm a professional violinist and a composer. I live in Cornwall in a very rural village right by the sea, so I'm very much surrounded by nature and the seasons on a daily basis. It kind of really literally comes in through my window. So, I'm currently doing the Sue Aston Show, and I'm also working on a new project called The Musical Diary of Composer, and I'm sort of launching myself on Patreon as well, so there's lots going on at the moment.
Cool. And is Cornwall where Doc Martin is filmed?
Yes, it is. I think everybody knows Cornwall for Doc Martin. I'd say we're probably about 50 miles away from Port Isaac, which is the real place where Doc Martin is filmed. And yes, we go there quite often and kind of peer through the window of his fictitious house. It's very exciting.
When I look at that, I am like, wow, even I could sing there. It's great to have you. And the topic, let me ask you something. What has nature meant to you in your career? And why, I mean, how did that begin for you?
I think nature really was a big part of my life from when I was little, and it's just followed, literally followed me around all of my life, and it's been part of my work. I was an only child, and I would just love sitting in the garden at home underneath a tree and just listening to the bird song. Because I didn't have any brothers and sisters, I felt that nature was my companion. And so, you know, my mum and dad were working and I was just sitting in the garden, and then I'd go and practice my violin. And so all along, really, nature and music has just been a constant companion. And luckily, it's turned into my career, which is very handy. And living in Cornwall, we're particularly surrounded by nature, all sorts of different landscapes, sacred sites, you know, the sea, which is amazing. So yeah, every day really, nature is part of my life and part of the inspiration for my work.
That was beautiful. Thank you so much. As you were speaking, I was just envisioning just everything that you said, and that touched me so much. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
I kind of pulled on the internet. There are so many different definitions of nature and the law of nature, and here's one. So it's a regularly occurring or apparently inevitable phenomenon observable in human society. And that observable is listening. So there's a thing going on constantly that we can listen to. And it's always there and it's inevitable. It's just whether we tune in or not, it's going on. And I think this show today is going to prove how fantastic it is to tune into this. For sharing that, I want to go to Heidi and ask her, what has nature meant to you in your life, and how has that affected?
For me, nature is a very, very important factor in my life. It gives me calmness. It gives me the awe of, you know, what life is, what the world is. I am surrounded by nature for many, many years, for 30 years. I'm living right in the middle of nowhere, let's say. And I love to listen to the birds, to watch the trees, to listen to the winds. For me, it's a source of recreation.
A source, okay, so we've got companion, a source of reconnection. That's beautiful, beautiful. And what about you, Gail? What's it meant to you in your work?
Well, I was thinking about this morning when I was getting ready for the show, and I remembered this blog post that I wrote actually about 7 months ago, and I was describing this experience that I had where I just needed to clear my head, and so I went to this park that was near my house, and they had this beautiful ravine. It was like this big circular ravine, and then there was these amazing rocks. It was just like these rocks, like hundreds and thousands of them. It seemed they were all over the place. It was a very striking beauty, you know, different kind of beauty with those rocks. And I took a blanket and I went down on there and I just laid down on those rocks for like 2 hours, and then I just felt so much better, and I went home. And I felt inspired to actually write about this, you know? And so I'm just going to read like two sentences. But it's like, so when I got home, I started wondering what had happened to me there. We're often told to seek out nature when we want to find inner peace. But why? What is it about being in nature that is so powerful? And I came up with this. Nature isn't encumbered by the busyness of everyday life. Sitting on those rocks was not like seeing God face to face on a clear day. It was seeing God face to face on a clear day and seeing myself as well. And I think that that's really what it means to me. It's like it's God, you know, and how much more real, and it's like seeing God and seeing myself.
That's perfect. Thank you for that. That's perfect. And Katrina, what about you?
For me, nature is a really important grounding tool. I found that when I'm not in nature enough or I'm around people too much, I kind of lose that balance that I have to come back to myself. So I've learned that nature is not only a calming and, you know, source of balance for me, but also a source of me to sort of regenerate my energy. And animals in particular have been a very big part of my life in terms of how I get information and sort of get some perspective. They're like little messengers for me. So in the whole context, yeah, I live in Colorado. It's a beautiful place to be. I've recently moved, so I'm around more nature, and I definitely can sense how my energy has shifted since being in my new home. So I love being surrounded by it, and it really provides that calmness in a way that nothing else seems to.
So before we go on, so that calmness, how do you get that calmness from what's around you? Well, how does that what's around you bring calmness? What is it?
I think it's the physically being outside and on the ground. You know, partly what Gail was talking about, when you're physically laying on the earth or parts of the earth, there's this grounding that takes place without you even having to be aware of it. And you can kind of feel the energy that's high energy, you know, anxiety kinds of energy or funky kind of energy, at least for me, kind of going into the earth kind of takes it up for you. And then once that kind of oozes out, then you can kind of sit in that calmness without actively having to do anything. I think that's why nature's so beautiful, is because it's not like you're actively doing anything. You're really passively sitting there and sort of taking in the experience. And that adds to the calmness because you're not actively doing something.
Right. You don't have to do anything. It's already there. Right? All you want to do is observe it, listen mm-hmm. to it, see what that is that you're observing. Mm-hmm. And I would welcome everybody that's in the comments to share how you see nature, what it's done for you, and what you tune into, and your messages that you get, because we'd love to hear them and we'd love to talk about them. And if you're listening to this and it's in the replay, write a comment, write us a reply, and let us know what you felt in nature and how it affects you. And I would say that it's pretty awesome to look around. You know, sometimes I'm walking and I'll just happen to glance at a piece of sky, and I'm like, wow, that's amazing. Or the birds around. Like, I'm in a bird sanctuary whenever I almost feel like it. And I can look at fish, and I can do all these things. And isn't it amazing that all of this exists? And then the other stuff, the stresses of everyday life, and all of those things just cannot compare to what we can experience in this connection to nature. And isn't it amazing what's available, the creativity and the beauty that surrounds us if we and when we tune into it? So I think it's just extraordinary for us to be having this conversation. It's right here. We don't have to do anything, as you said. We don't take any action. We don't do anything. We just have to enjoy it and see what it's telling us. So I'd love to hear, Heidi, is there any comments? Not yet.
There are some comments, but mainly from Sheila, about sort of reconnecting what we are saying.
Okay. Elaine, you with us?
I am. Hello, everybody. I'm really happy to be with you today. My reflections about nature, I missed some of the earlier comments, so I've just opened up to ask the question, what am I led to say in this moment? And while the thought about connecting to nature might often have us think, well, I want to be in a setting where there's a lot of greenery and trees or this growing nature around. But the truth is, sometimes we might be in an environment where that's just not as accessible as we would like. So let's say you're living in an urban environment, or you're on a business project and you're in downtown Manhattan or wherever. You know, in that place, you actually can connect to nature. You can close your eyes and pay attention to the ground, the earth. You can connect to the earth. You might even close your eyes and just feel into the movement of the air that happens to be there that day, the temperature, or the quality of the sunlight, the light or dark, that happens to be just in the landscape that you're in. And just get curious, what's the blessing in the configuration of nature right where I am? Let me be curious to experience that with either the sound, the feeling of the earth, the light that happens to be here.
Beautiful. Yeah, I often feel blessed when I have that warmth. You know, it's like Sue said, that companion. You know, you feel it. So that's a great way to describe it, Elaine. Thank you. Sue, I want to come back to you and give you the floor. And I'd like you to talk some about your process in creating music and doing what you do, and how you get inspired, but how does the wind inspire you? Or just talk some about your process and how you use nature to create your music.
Okay, well, the good thing about living in Cornwall is that because it's like a peninsula, you're very much surrounded by the changes within the weather. So literally you can be on the north coast and it can be very windy and stormy. And then if you go to the south coast, it's much calmer. So, and literally it's probably about, say, 2 or 3 miles at the very tip of the country. So you can experience different kind of weather situations quite easily. So it's very varied, really, and it's very inspiring for my music. One minute I can feel a bit battered by the wind, and I can kind of hear sounds in the trees when the wind is blowing through the trees. And then other times, if I'm sitting on the coastal path, I can just listen to the sea, and that's very calming. If it's a beautiful day, I might, you know, write some very relaxing music. So the weather, as well as the beautiful landscape down here, you know, it's just being aware of your surroundings and listening to the bird song and all sorts of things like that. Yeah, it's very inspiring.
So when you're amidst all this and there's wind, how do you determine, or how are you defining, how are you reading the message that you get? How do you feel it?
Well, I think really it depends on not just the wind, but maybe the light in the sky. If it's a bit dark and foreboding, then I'm going to write some dramatic music. But if the sun's shining and there's lots of animals around and birds in the sky, then that has a completely different feel. and my music's going to be more lyrical and more relaxing. So, yeah, and literally within an hour or so, that mood can change. So I have to hurry up and write down the music as I think of it.
So you're writing based on this mood? Do you feel these things in different parts of your body? How do you connect with it?
Yeah, I mean, almost just sitting on the ground, you can almost feel the heartbeat of the earth. And that in itself can kind of set up a beat for you to write the music to. So by sitting on the earth and feeling the beat and then listening to the sounds in the landscape, the wind in the trees, then you kind of get the rhythms. And then listening to the bird's song, then you kind of get tunes. So it's like the whole of nature is coming together and writing this music, and I'm just sitting there absorbing it.
And what is it about nature that makes it so important to express it in music? Why is nature so important to you?
I think really it goes way back to when I was growing up, and I just felt this bond with nature. Nature was there keeping me company. Almost like a family member. I know that sounds strange, or a best friend, but we're all at the mercy of nature, aren't we? So nature is the most important thing, really. And I think it's just recognizing the importance of nature that just takes me over. It just literally, yeah, just takes over me, and I can just hear all this music.
So it speaks through you. So that's
yeah.
Okay. So I want to see anybody on our panel, in our green room, that has a question, something that you've been dealing with, or something you're curious about, anything. And I'd love to hear what you all have to say or ask. And then Sue's going to bless us with a little music. And then we're going to talk about that. So, Heidi, do you have anything that you would like to add or ask Sue?
Yeah, I would like to ask how this process is from listening. Do you hear the melody then, and then you just write it down, or how is it? How does it appear, this music, in your inner ear?
Well, it can be different on different days. Literally, sometimes I'm just sitting and just being very still in nature, and then tunes will just pop into my head. I'm aware of the sounds of nature, and then just literally tunes will just come into my mind. And then sometimes if I've been out for a walk, maybe late at night, at dusk, because I love dusk. I love dusk and early morning. Then I'll go to sleep, and then I'll wake up in the middle of the night, and there'll be a tune going around my head. And so I have to get up and write it down, because I know that if I don't, and I wake up the next morning, it's gone. So I really feel as though it's a gift. It's almost like someone saying, here's this tune. This is your chance to write it down. If you don't want it, I'm going to give it to someone else. So that does tend to get you out of bed.
So it is not necessarily that you hear the music in nature with the bird songs and you transport it directly. This is sort of a transformation process, and it comes then as a unit, as a melody, as sort of how do you say, a whole music into your awareness.
Yeah, I mean, it's different on different days. I mean, literally I can hear sounds in the landscape, you know, especially so stormy down here in Cornwall. And we have a lot of hawthorn trees down here, and you can hear the rattling of the branches and the twigs. It's very percussive. And also because we live near a harbour, you can hear the all the stuff on the ships and the boats. You can hear all the rigging sort of rattling against the metal and the wood. And that makes me think of rhythms. So it's quite hard to relax, actually, because I think most people find nature relaxing, but it kind of triggers off this process in my mind. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting, because if nature is your work,
yeah,
you know, we always feel relaxed in doing our work, as opposed to somebody who is just enjoying it for enjoyment's sake.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. I have a question for Sue, a follow-up. So, Sue, when you're doing this I'll call it capturing and then translation process. Are you notating on computer? Are you notating on paper? Are you hearing a melody and singing in it into something that you are recording? Or you led maybe sometime to just pick up a fiddle and like play it and capture it via recording? Tell us a little bit about you capture it and then have a place where you've saved it.
Actually, all of those things. I'm very versatile. sometimes I take my violin out into the landscape when it's really remote and quiet, and I will play my violin, and I can always feel the wind moving my fingers, and sometimes the wind picks up the strings. It will make a sound, almost like pick up the harmonics, and the wind will go through the bow. You can feel it moving. So yeah, sometimes I literally play in the landscape. Other times I take my manuscript, I've got a little manuscript book, and I take that out and write to my music as I think of it. And then other times, if I'm not so prepared, I've got my phone with me and I think of a tune, then I will hum it into the phone and record it and save it up for when I get home and write it out. All sorts of ways. I don't really use a computer unless I'm arranging other parts, so it's quite an organic process really for the actual tune. That really just comes from me, just writing it down, I use a computer mainly when I'm adding other instruments so that I can hear what it will sound like.
So for example, if you're adding other instruments, then you might start out with an initial melody or primary melody, and then you hear the harmony or another tempo or percussive something that comes in the background, and those kind of emerge one by one, and then you capture those layers.
Yeah, that's
again,
right.
Probably in a variety of ways.
Exactly, yeah, it's exactly that. And sometimes I'll play it on the piano as well and get like the harmonies. Once I've got the melody down, then I'll work on the harmonies on the piano and harmonize the melody and then go to the computer and add other instruments.
Do you ever have like words that come into mind during this process so that there's like a title to the piece which kind of emerges concurrently? Or might emerge later? I'm curious about that part of the process.
I think usually the title comes while I'm writing the music, or sometimes it can be after it's completed. But they always have working titles. So as soon as I've written something down, I'll have to call it something to make it more real. So a piece of music might have like a working title, and then later on I'll just jiggle it a little bit and think, oh no, that's what I want to call it. It might be something to do with where I've been that's inspired the music, or maybe a story, but.
It's fascinating to have this opportunity to converse with you.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I'm just elaborating a little bit. Okay, I'd like to question. Thanks.
Yeah, as we get on, because I think it would be really interesting to decide how you humanly, you know, express what we see. I mean, how we listen and how we get it out. So I think that's very important. And I see that there's a comment. Heidi has a comment. Heidi, you want to give us the comment?
Yeah, the assured user says, does Sue Aston feel a different connection to the different parts of nature? Like the ocean and the waves crashing on the shore evoke a different feeling or connection in me than taking a walk in the woods by a stream. I tend to be drawn to water in all its glorious forms. And then I add also Lisa Howard, who says, big nature, the ocean, a storm, the Grand Canyon, keeps me grounded and helps to keep my life in perspective.
So Sue, based on that comment, you feel different things from different parts of nature.
Yeah, definitely.
They elicit different experiences for you that you are able to then give out and relay to your music.
Yeah, it's kind of all to do with the moods, really. So if you've got like a crashing ocean, then the music's going to be more dramatic. If I'm by a stream or something, then it's going to be more lyrical and relaxing. And again, the weather comes into play. So it's very different at different times and very different at different times of the day and the seasons as well. So it's like a kaleidoscope of moods all the time. It's always changing.
Yeah. So you are part of the law of nature. Gail, what about you? Gail, do you have, and Gail's a writer, so, you know, her perspective could be a little different. You know, Elaine does work with laughter. So, you know, her relationship with nature could be even a little bit different. Like, you know, I can see her laughing at things, you know, as she sees them, you know, the humor in what we see in nature. Gail, you might see something different. So what from what perspective and what kind of questions would you have for Sue? Or for any one of us?
What do I write about? I'm sorry. Is that what you said?
What kind of a quest? Do you have anything that you want to ask Sue or anybody on the panel in how we deal with nature, how we see nature, or do you have a specific question for Sue in her process or anything?
Yeah, thank you.
Or anything about nature that you want to express?
Sure. Well, actually, Sue, when I was just, so many things came to my mind when I listened to you speak about nature before that I was going to comment on, but now you just said something else, so I'll comment on that. In terms of the creativity, like how you're affected by the nature. And this is where it comes into me being a writer also, because it's that creative process. I think whether you're creating music or dancing or writing or art, you know, it's just the medium is just the medium, but it's like that creativity can come through. And I was thinking how, as a creative person, nature is so powerful because nature is the ultimate creativity. I mean, that you can't get any more creative than dealing with nature. That's what it is. And so, I don't know if you, it sounds like what you were saying, and I feel this way for me, that I can begin creating almost as a reflection of the ultimate creator, which is nature, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, absolutely. It's the force of nature, isn't it? And
yes.
Nature drives everything. It drives all of us. Even in this technological age and people working in offices with tiny little windows, you know, nature is still behind everything. It's what keeps us on our feet, you know, gravity and the whole thing. So, yeah, it's a massive part of everybody's life, really. Yeah. And I think we're lucky if we can tune into it, you know. It's great, isn't it, if we are able to have the time to do that.
It's that incredible force. You know, it's like we can't reckon with nature. It's primal, you know. We revolve around nature. In a sense, we're at the mercy of nature, and I think that we could really become so humbled by that, you know, and also express ourselves through it, you know, be empowered by it, I guess, and it comes through our creativity.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, you also touched upon some things that are really, really relevant, and I'm sure Katrina will add to that. But, you know, and we're talking everybody's creative. You know, we've all been created, and we are creative. So for somebody who doesn't, you know, recognize their creativity, for somebody who may not write, sing, draw, paint, create something, music, on a regular basis, I think it's really important for us to help suggest opportunities as well for anybody to help connect to nature, and why that is so important for somebody who is in that room, you know, with a small window, who may get into work in the darkness and leave in the darkness and not maybe recognize the value. Why is it so valuable to tune in? What is there that you will get, and why should they? So, Katrina.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a specific question? I'm sorry,
well, I didn't. As Gail, you're a wonderful writer as well.
Yeah.
And you have a way of coining things beautifully. You know, all are just magnificent at that. I'm sitting here and I'm going, oh, yeah, that's what I meant. Oh, yeah, you said it great. So, tell us from your perspective, why is nature so relevant? Why is it so important for all of us, whether we are recognizing our creativity or we're not?
I really think it comes down to it being that primal force. You know, we're made of the same components of the earth. The universe is all made of the same components of the earth. Like, it's really an integral part of who we are. And I think when we get very detached from that, we step out of our own flow. And, you know, I liked how you were mentioning, like, well, what about those people that, you know, maybe don't necessarily know that they're creative, but, you know, don't really have space in their day to be creative in that way. You know, there are so many opportunities now to listen to music that's nature. That's all it is nature sounds. So maybe you can't get outside and connect in that way as often as you would like, or maybe the weather just doesn't, you know, it's inclement weather, it's a poor season. It doesn't necessarily mean that you can't have access to that sound and sort of sit in it and absorb it just by listening to it through an audio recording. And then I'm sure obviously music, like the material that Sue puts together, that helps with that, because you even have at a deeper level that element of nature happening in music. So that is, I think, a really helpful way to get people to sort of connect in that space if they can't really get outside. But I would actually love to ask Sue what her recommendation would be for people that maybe don't have that time. I don't know if there's something else that she would suggest, or for folks that that struggle with sort of tuning in that way, if she's got any recommendations for that from a music perspective.
Well, I think people are generally so busy, you know, traveling to work and being at work. But when you're traveling to work, that is an opportunity, even if you're driving to work, is to wind the window down and just feel the fresh air. Hopefully there is some fresh air. and just sitting by the window at work, you know, in your coffee break, just feel the breeze on your face. You know, even if you're working at night, you can still feel the breeze. And, yeah, I think it's that sort of thing. Even, I don't know. Yeah, just trying to listen to music when you're traveling on an iPod or something. Try and listen to music that is more relaxing or dramatic, that inspires you to think of nature. It's kind of, yeah, there's so many things you can do, really, but I think you have to plan it and do it. Otherwise, the day flashes by and, you know, really quickly, and you've missed it, and then you're all depressed, and then it's bedtime.
It's almost like people can look at nature as an invitation. It's an invitation that's always there. It's up to you to connect with it or take advantage of it.
That's right. It's up to you to notice it, isn't it? And the more you notice it, the more it will become part of your life, I think.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Right. And that's the listening piece. The more you listen to it, the more it becomes a part of your life. And nature helps us be alive. Mm-hmm. It helps us feel alive. And there's a rhythm in everything. Everything has a rhythm, doesn't it? I mean, silence has a rhythm. You know, the trees have a rhythm. Animals, everything has a rhythm. And we're in it. We're in this whole big thing. And it helps us feel alive and part of all of that rhythm by tuning in.
Marilyn, I just want to add that our heartbeat has a rhythm, too.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
Mm-hmm. And what about that, Gail?
Well, we were talking about the different, you know, that everything has a rhythm, but it goes to the core of our heart, you know? I mean, it doesn't get any closer to us than our heart.
Exactly. I mean, haven't any of you sat with a drum? Had somebody sit with a drum and they pound on that drum? I mean, you can literally feel the pounding of the drum in your heart. I'm such a mood to that rhythm. That's absolutely perfect. So, I think this is a good time for Sue to play us some music. And then let's see what we can tell from her music, like where she was, or, you know, how that makes you feel. Let's kind of play a game with it, I think. Sue?
Okay. Yeah, I'll play you a tune. You might have heard it before, but maybe some of you haven't. So, and I'm not going to say what it's called. So I'm going to play it and see what people think it reminds them of. Okay, so I'm just going to change over to studio setting.
And I would say something. I would like to invite you to listen not only with your ears, but with the whole body. We were talking about the rhythm of the body. You said the drums, but you can really learn to listen to music with the whole body.
Thank you for saying that. She is so right on with that. Listen, and not just with your head to try to figure it out. Just allow your body to figure it out. Heidi, that was great. So, could you tell us any cues to find the head? People that get to listen to that who might be tuning in and go, wow.
Oh, thank you.
I don't even know what this, I mean, I have a vision, but I'm going to let Heidi start. How did that talk to you, Heidi?
You know, I don't see it in concepts. I just felt the high notes. I felt them going up and down in my head and the lower notes going down in my body. I mean, a violin probably cannot go down onto the feet, but it arrives at least at the heart. And I can follow this melody by feeling it inside my body, and I really enjoy that. It feels so alive.
Thank you. Thank
you. And I want to hear another beat.
Yeah. That was great. And I loved what Heidi just said. She's so alive. That was beautiful. Your music is alive. Your creativity is alive. Your connection to nature is all one, and it's alive. That was just wonderful. Thank you for that, Heidi. Lane, what about you?
I closed my eyes, and I began experiencing imagery all during the different textures and tempos and colors that were emerging in the different sounds. And so the first thing that I began feeling was like that I was like a person at the shoreline of an ocean, at the sand, and the waves were lapping in, and there were various waves with ripples and tempos. And yet I also sensed like darkness, that it was late evening, And like if I was looking upon the water, that it would seem dark blue or black, but little flickers of reflections of the foam from time to time.
Very good.
Then I heard, a different texture or tempo come in, and it was like the wind was kicking up, and it was adding rhythm, and maybe it was blowing trees that were nearby, and I was sensing that. And then toward the end, as the pitch was elevated for the melody, then I felt like, oh, now I'm hearing birds that are sailing over the area and dancing with the different rhythms that were there. So I did experience in my own way a little mini symphony with the different textures and feelings that you might have felt in your environment, whatever it happened to be. But the music elicited those images for me, and it was very rich and beautiful.
Fantastic. Wonderful.
Thank you. It's really great to have a different perspective on something and to see where we go with it, because we're all entitled to that, and it makes it really interesting to see what we can do with something. So, Gail, what about you?
Sue, I just have to say that was really one of the most exquisite pieces of music that I have ever heard, and it brought me to tears.
Oh my goodness!
No, I mean that was. I'm very musically. I just love music, and I'm just blown away by the beauty of that. That was just really incredible. When I was listening to it, at one point I started thinking about, oh, well, what am I going to say about this music when I'm thinking, when later on? And as soon as I started thinking, I didn't hear the music anymore. It was really beautiful.
Thank you, Gail. That's lovely of you to say. Thank you.
And when
I was listening to the music, like before I came on the show, I had a lot of stuff on my mind. And I think that the music was such a release for me. It's like it just hit me to the core. And so everything that I was like worrying about before or thinking about before, it just like all disappeared. Mm-hmm. And it just all became really unimportant because of that music. It just really cut to the truth and what's really important.
Oh, thank you, Gail. That's great.
I would like to talk about the comments. There's Lisa Howard who says, "Send me to windy barren hilltops. Oh my gosh, what a gift. Thank you."
Oh.
And Sheila says, "Brought beautiful emotions up for me as well as Gail."
Brilliant. Thank you, everyone.
And I'm back. Thank you. I miss what Katrina said. I'm sorry, and I got called away for a minute from the whiff of the music, I guess. For me, I actually, it's interesting. I was thinking about what you all were saying, and I guess I think in emotion, and I express myself in emotion, and I felt people communicating with each other, like a conversation, like a real powerful emotional conversation between people, like two people, like a woman and a man communicating and expressing themselves. And I closed my eyes and I felt that there was an entire orchestra, not just one violin, mm-hmm. but so much going on at one time.
Oh,
and
thank
I really,
you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for exposing me and all of us to share experiences and for people to know that everybody doesn't have to have the same experience. And I think that's what's so valuable about what we do here in particular, because we can share the same thing, we can feel a similar thought, but it's our thought, it's your thought. Everybody gets to experience something unique. And in nature, I'm looking out of my eyes, I'm looking out of my heart, as you all are, and you get to experience it, enjoy it, for whatever it means to you in that moment. And I guess Where were you, Sue, when you did that? What was your inspiration?
Well, it's just been so interesting hearing all of your comments, because you've all got the whole story covered, all of you. It's a piece of music called Nancy's Garden, and I wrote it in a very small cove called Porthgwara, and it's a beautiful, really unspoilt cove down here in Cornwall. So I was writing it on the headland, and the headland was called Nancy's Garden because it tells of a story about a young girl called Nancy and her love, and they were very much in love, but her dad didn't approve and sent him away to go and prove himself and work on a ship, that sort of thing. And so she's pacing up and down on the headland waiting for him to come back, and I think the middle section that was quite rhythmic had quite an insistent feel to it. It starts off nice and calm, you know, like the love story that it is, but then it gets that kind of tension in it, which is her pacing up and down on the headland at night, looking out for him coming back in the ship. And then, unfortunately, he drowns, and then they're not together. So, and again, it was a conversation between the man and the woman. And with all good tales, of course, they are reunited at the end as ghosts. So you were all correct with everything that you said. There's lots going on in that little tune.
Let me ask you something. So based on what you just said, that we all, and I was listening to everybody, but I couldn't, I kind of left when Katrina started speaking. But based on what you just said, that everybody had the story, a piece of the story, an experience from the music, what do you think about that? How do you feel about that?
I think it's amazing, because when I write music, it usually starts off on the violin or the piano, but then I add other instruments to it to make it bigger, because for me, it's each piece that I play, it's very visual, and it's almost like a soundtrack. Each little bit's like its own mini film. So to get up and play the violin, just the violin melody, and to get all that across, quite a challenge if you think about it. But I try not to think about it too much. I just think about playing the melody and feel the mood of the piece. So I'm just so pleased that you all picked up on all those different aspects of the piece of music. That was amazing. Thank you.
I found it really sad.
Yeah, I'm pretty late.
Now, I was just saying that when I listened to it, I found it a very sad piece of music in a way. It just evoked a kind of sadness in me. And what came to my mind was actually Fiddler on the Roof. And you know what? I mean, that's a very sad, you know, it ends very sadly, and they all have to leave their home. And I don't know, maybe that's why I felt like I was almost evoked to tears in a sense, because it was a sad, I don't know, it just made me feel, it was gorgeous, but it, you know, I mean, life is sad sometimes. It's just a part of life, and just that's how it hit me.
Yeah, it's kind of bittersweet, isn't it? It seems quite a harmless little melody. It seems quite relaxing to start with, but then it's very haunting at the same time, isn't it? So
yeah. It's
a mixture of emotions, I think.
It was. I think very quickly it came in with that haunting kind of...
It's interesting. There is a video on YouTube for Nancy's Garden, and when I was shooting the video and I was playing along and I was being filmed, we didn't know, but there was a man watching. I don't know, he was just behind a rock or something. He was probably having a picnic, poor man, and we all descended on him with violins and cameras. When I finished playing, he came up to me and the tears were streaming down his face. And he came up and shook my hand and he says, "I just want to thank you for that." And I was like, "Oh, I didn't know you were there." But he was just in tears. And I'll never forget that. That was just so unusual for that to happen. In the middle of nowhere, it was very remote.
Interesting. I find it so fascinating how we each come from something different. We do some different things. And yet, we all have been able to, you know, understand the message in that piece of music. What does that tell you? What's the possibility in that message? And we don't have much time left, so which one of you would like to add that in a very short thing? What is the message in that for the world when they listen to this show about nature, about art? What's the message? Anybody?
I've got that. I've got it. I've just got this one. You know, it's like nature and music, they're all, it's the universal language. That's what brings us together. We could all speak different things, but when we listen to the music and we look at the stars, we all understand. We're all connected to each other.
Very good.
Yes, great. Go ahead. Go ahead. Somebody have something to say at that point?
No, but I can say something.
That's great. Go ahead, say it.
Yeah, for me, music has this possibility to touch your heart, and nature has the possibility to touch your heart. And it is all, as Gail said, it is together. Music is a sort of a translation of nature into your heart. And somebody can get it better by music. I felt it very melancholy in this music, which is really sort of opening the heart, you know. And somebody gets it by other things, by seeing a sunset or something, you know. But it is the potential of really touching us and really emotionally opening for us human beings.
Yeah, and it is the universal language, and there is something to be heard. There is a meaning of life that we get to experience. It's an emotional experience, and we get to experience it and understand it. So, yeah, I love where this has gone. Anybody else in the next minute have something else to add to that? Katrina?
I would like to just echo what Heidi said earlier. It's that music allows you to listen with all of your senses, including your whole body. And what an amazing experience, because usually we're so focused on using one of our senses at a time. And music is a really amazing invitation to listen with your whole body.
Exactly.
Hi. And I'd like to wind up just saying this show is a reminder that there's so many beautiful ways where we can do self-care. And that self-care can be the engagement with nature, going out and just being in that curious place to open up to the rhythms, the sights, the textures, the sounds, let that evoke the music within our own heart to connect with that. And then also to listen to recorded music inspired by nature, to help us find peace, help us connect to the life and love that's all around us.
Beautiful. And it's listening that takes us to all of those points, all of those life points. Listening takes us there. And I see that Heidi has a comment. Heidi, you want to read that to us?
Yeah, Sheila is participating in our round. It's so nice that she is there. She said, music nature brings us together. So true.
Music what? Say that again.
Music and nature brings us together.
Yes. That's what listening does. Listening brings us together. That's beautiful. Sue, what about you in the final moment? How would you like to leave us all? How would you like to leave us all? What's the final message from you?
Well, I think no matter what job we do, wherever we are in our lives, wherever we live, we can all connect to nature and it will make a difference to our lives. It will make us more creative as people in our jobs. It'll make us more compassionate to people, you know, have more empathy and just open that window and smell the fresh air.
Perfect. And I appreciate that ending because that's exactly how we want people. Well, we'd love for people to have an experience with that and live their lives from that perspective. Next week, we're going to be here, same time, 11 a.m. Eastern time, going profound into a topic. And I think the next topic we're going to talk about is listening for our strengths and listening to toot our horn. We don't do that enough. We don't even do that, period. And so next week, we're going to be talking about how we listen for that. And so I welcome all of you to join us again, 11 o'clock Eastern Time for SkyWire and these incredible people that show up in this room each and every week that take us deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And they take us there through listening and exploring. So thank you all very much for being here. Sue It's been a pleasure. Everybody out there, we love that you're here, and we love that you show up and add to so much of the show each and every week. Please keep coming back. And
thank
everybody
you.
In the green room, hold on. Anybody else? Anybody else? Final words.